Hi, my name is Brian Klee, and this is my midterm project for CSC 582 in the spring of 2016. My midterm is in the form of a video essay on the topic of film discourse, specifically on introducing techniques in film discourse and how they apply to narrative. So, what is film discourse? Film discourse is the language that lets us talk about the cinematic techniques used in film. Even outside of narrative, this concept is critical. When you're watching a film, it's important to remember that every single element of its presentation has been meticulously crafted by a director and their cinematographer. If we then consider narrative, it's critical for our ability to discuss the narrative implications of the director's choices to have some language and understanding of film techniques, or our discourse. Specifically, in this video essay, I'm going to walk through the major techniques used in film discourse and exemplify them in detail, taking time to focus on the possible narrative implications of each technique. So without further ado, let's begin. First, let's consider film discourse in a more broad and general way. We'll refer to this as our visual rhetoric. The main themes of visual rhetoric that we will discuss are image and movement. We're going to start off with image, specifically talking about types of camera shots, different camera angles, and color. So let's talk about camera shots. It's our first major technique in film discourse. This is also perhaps the broadest category of film discourse, and it can be broken into multiple subcategories. The easiest category of camera shots deals with the actual distance of the camera to its subjects in the scene. We will start with the farthest example, the extreme long shot. The extreme long shot is a panoramic type view of almost always an exterior location, simply because of the distance on the shot. These shots are taken from long distances away, sometimes up to a quarter of a mile away. Because of the nature of these shots, the object generally occupies a small ratio of screen space in relation to their setting, which is displayed clearly to the audience as their overwhelming surroundings. From a narrative standpoint, the utility of this shot lies in the ability of the environment to foreground a central character. This can be used in a variety of ways. It might demonstrate a character's solitude and isolation, or it might show the sort of environment that explains a character's emotional state. Let's take, for example, this scene in The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King, where the beacons of Gondor are being lit. It is important to note that prior to this scene, Gandalf and Pippin have ridden to Minas Tirith to aid them against Sauron's coming forces. Yet because their leader Denethor refuses to call for help, Gandalf convinces Pippin to secretly light the beacon atop Minas Tirith. Following this act, the audience watches as a domino-like effect occurs as the beacons are lit far across the land, finally reaching the eyes of Aragorn, who can use this call for help to finally muster the Rohirrim's aid. The use of this extreme long shot here is critical to convey the sense of distance and companionship across the land, and to demonstrate that even in a time when all seems lost, men's collective forces span wide enough and far enough that they just might make it out okay. Following the extreme long shot, we of course have the long shot, which shows the scene from a distance as one might view a play in a theater. However, due to time, we're going to pass over this shot and move on to the medium shot, or mid shot. The medium shot is a relatively close shot, revealing a moderate amount of detail. A medium shot of a figure generally includes the body from the knees or the waist up, and it's one of the most common shots used in film. Medium shots are generally used in scenes where there's a small group of people acting and sharing a dialogue. It gives the audience both a good view of the speakers, showing their facial expressions and body language, but also a partial view of their background. Take this scene from In Bruges, where two of the main characters are having a conversation outside. Even without hearing the dialogue, which has been left out due to severe profanity, by using a medium shot, the audience is able to see in detail the facial expressions of both men, and can immediately recognize that one has become severely offended by the other's words. Narratively, this type of shot is perhaps the best default shot we have, as it portrays characters' emotions through their facial detail and body language. And this is obviously reflected by its widespread use in films. After the medium shot comes the close-up shot, or close shot. This shot shows a detailed view of a person or an object, usually without much context provided. The distance between a close shot and a medium shot can sometimes become blurred, as there is no discrete distance that defines each. The shot we just examined from In Bruges, for example, is sort of a halfway shot between a medium and a close. Because of this, we're going to move on to our next shot, the extreme close-up shot, which leaves no ambiguity. The extreme close-up is a minutely detailed view of an object or person. An extreme close-up of an actor, for example, generally only includes his eyes or his mouth. The extreme close-up shot is unique in that it allows the audience to enter the character's intimate space, possibly revealing certain characteristics and emotions that would have otherwise gone unnoticed from afar. This unnaturally close view intensifies feelings the character is experiencing, and from a narrative standpoint, gives viewers a view into their internal character state, a tricky thing to do in film, allowing us to feel sympathy for and establish a connection with them. Take, for instance, this opening shot from Pink Floyd's The Wall. This scene began with an extreme close-up of the main character's wristwatch, followed by a close-up of his burnt-out cigarette, and then closes in on his face. The next scene will show flashbacks of riots and war. This example of an extreme close-up successfully sets the tone and mood for the film, in which we as the audience establish an emotional connection with the main character, Pink, leading us into the film questioning his alienation and pain. This technique is then continually revisited throughout the film to maintain this critical connection with the viewer. Aside from just the distance of the camera to the scene, there are also other important techniques specifically involving the camera shot. For example, we have the zoom. Zooming is a simple concept to understand. A zoom shot occurs when the cameraman used a zoom lens to change from a wide angle to a telephoto shot, and vice versa, in one continuous movement. Zoom shots are when the director makes use of one of these zoom lenses to change the focal length during a shot, so that a dolly or a crane shot is suggested. Also, don't worry, I'm going to explain those concepts later on. For now, let's focus on this scene from Shaun of the Dead. Here, we can see how quick cuts and zooms can create a narrative comedic effect on the scene. Normally, quick zooms are used as a narrative tool to increase pace and tension, making simple actions carry more weight. We usually see them in action films, yet here, in Shaun of the Dead, we can see how the director plays off of this convention on everyday activities, like putting jam on your toast. Next, we are going to discuss the establishing shot. An establishing shot is usually a long shot offered at the beginning of a scene or sequence, providing the viewer with the context of the subsequent closer shots that will follow. Establishing shots used to be more common, but they are still critical to understand and recognize today. From a narrative standpoint, the establishing shot provides four core functions. First off, these shots can establish a location by showing famous landmarks or skylines, giving context on where the following scenes will take place. As well, they can establish the time of day. By following a character during the day, we can assume that their subsequent scenes will also take place at the same time. They can also establish relationships by introducing a room with all of the pertinent characters inside the shot. We know that they have some relationship with each other. And finally, they can establish a concept. This is done by showing some sort of action, which can then be taken as a core theme for the following scenes. Finally, we have our last shot, the over-the-shoulder shot. The over-the-shoulder shot is a special form of a medium shot, and it is incredibly useful in dialogue scenes. The way it works is that when two characters are having a dialogue, one of them will be filmed head-on from over the shoulder of the other actor. As I mentioned, this is a common technique for filming dialogue, and it's used frequently in modern film. Now, let's take a look at a scene from No Country for Old Men.
You know what date is on this coin?
No.
1958. It's been traveling 22 years to get here. And now it's here. And it's either heads or tails. And you have to say, call it.
Look, I need to know what I stand to win.
Everything.
How's that?
You stand to win everything, call it.
All right. Heads then.
What we just watched was an entire scene of just dialogue. No action ever occurred. The two characters barely even moved from the duration of the shots. Yet, they shared an intense dialogue, and because of the use of the over-the-shoulder shot, we as the audience were able to follow the entire conversation from start to finish. This may seem like a trivial notion, but it's actually a cornerstone to the way dialogues are conveyed in visual narratives. We have now finished up our conversation on specific shots under the theme of images and visual rhetoric. Moving on from camera shots, another important discourse technique related to the camera and image is the actual angle of the camera during the shot. Let's start with the classic bird's eye view. A bird's eye view shot is fairly self-explanatory. It's a shot in which the camera photographs a scene from directly overhead. However, because of the nature of the shot being a very unnatural and strange angle, the entire scene can be disorienting. Familiar objects viewed from this angle might seem totally unrecognizable at first. The shot, however, does put the audience in a godlike position, and because of this, the shot is frequently referred to as the God's Eye View, looking down on all of the action. When using a shot like the bird's eye view, people can be made to look insignificant, small, and ant-like, or part of a wider scheme of things. The next camera angle we are going to discuss is the high-angle shot. A high-angle shot is a shot in which the subject is photographed from above, yet not so extreme as the bird's eye view. Usually, the camera is elevated above the action using a crane to give a general overview of the scene. High angles make the object photographed seem smaller and less significant. The object or character often gets swallowed up by their setting, and they become part of a wider picture. When talking about high-angle shots, it's impossible not to mention Alfred Hitchcock, who used this type of shot excessively throughout his films. High-angle shots in Hitchcock's films often occurs when the main character comes to a realization of some terrible truth. They are also used to signify that a person is depressed or in a crisis. Often these two are combined for a terrifying effect. In general, Hitchcock uses these shots in four different narrative ways. As I've already mentioned, he uses these to show depression or shock. He also uses them to show danger. From a great height or a high angle, the camera shows the dangerous situation a character might be in. He uses them to show the viewpoint of a character high above the rest of the scene. And finally, broadly, he uses them to give an overview of the scene. Finally, the last camera angle shot we will discuss is the low angle shot. A low angle shot is one in which the subject is photographed from below. These types of shots can be used for multiple scenarios. For one, these increase the perspective height of the subjects, which can be useful for short actors. They can also give a sense of speed and motion. Furthermore, low angle shots can help give a sense of confusion to a viewer, of powerlessness within the action of a scene, especially from the point of view of the low angle. Yet perhaps the most famous use of low-angle shots is from director Quentin Tarantino, who has perfected a unique twist on the low-angle shot over the course of his career, the trunk shot. A Tarantino trunk shot involves placing a camera inside some sort of trunk. This could literally be a car trunk, or it could be something similar to a trunk, like a box or a chest. By placing the camera inside an object that the subjects will interact with, Tarantino creates a unique low-angle shot, looking up at the subjects as they open the trunk. That wraps up our discussion on image specifically related to the location of the camera. Now that we are done talking about shots and angles, let's move into the last technique in our image theme, color. Let's begin where it all started, with black and white. Originally, due to film technology, all films were in black and white. Yet over the years, we have fully embraced our colorful world. So why do we still see uses of black and white palettes in modern film? Well, for a number of reasons. For one, black and white can be a relatively simple way to evoke memories of the past. Take Schindler's List, for example, which was shot almost entirely in black and white to harken back to its setting during World War II. Alternatively, up until the advent of readily available digital filming technologies, films like Clerks were shot in black and white largely in part because of budget considerations. Nowadays, in modern film, black and white is mainly used as an artistic choice. From a narrative standpoint, it's often used to force audiences to focus more on the story content rather than the distractions of a colorful world. Moving on from black and white, we of course have color. But since nearly every modern film is in color, it's important that we make the distinction between using color for color's sake and using color specifically as an artistic and directorial standpoint. For the purposes of our discussions, I will simply refer to this latter category as vibrant color. On further inspection, however, it isn't just the presence of colors that interests us from a narrative standpoint, but rather the color palette established and used throughout the film. A color palette is a limited number of specific colors used or emphasized throughout the film in order to subtly communicate various aspects of character and story to the viewer. Take, for instance, these scenes from the film Hero. This film makes elaborate and consistent use of dominant color palettes in beautifully artistic and narratively critical ways. Besides just the beauty of these scenes, the color palettes help audience keep track of different characters, as they are each in turn introduced with a new color palette accompanying them. As well, these colors serve to help distinguish important characters from the seas of enemies they may be cutting through. And finally, the color palettes accompanying each character and scene help to underscore the central themes behind each of the encounters. And now we have finished the first and largest group of our visual rhetoric themes, image. Having discussed shots, angles, and color, let's move on to our last theme, movement. Specifically in movement, we're concerned with the camera's actual movement across a scene. Whether it's being carried by a cameraman or on a dolly, or even just pivoted on a tripod. Here we are interested in the types of shots that can be created this way and their narrative implications. Let's start with the tracking shot. The tracking shot, also known as the dolly shot or a trucking shot, is a shot taken from a moving vehicle. Originally, tracks were physically laid on the set to prevent a smoother motion of the camera. But today, thanks to the advent of Steadicam technology, even a smooth handheld traveling shot is considered a variation of the tracking shot. Tracking shots are used in a variety of ways, and they are perhaps the most common movement technique. A director may use a tracking shot to dolly in on a stationary subject for emphasis. Alternatively, frequently you will see a tracking shot in which the camera follows a subject within the frame, such as a moving actor or a vehicle. This clip from Path of Glory shows a third use of a tracking shot, to simply move throughout an entire scene. Here, the trenches during World War I. By tracking through the scene, the audience gets to experience what it would be like to walk through these trenches, seeing the faces of the men as the shot tracks through, and they can physically place themselves effectively in the scene because of this. The next technique of movement we will discuss is a variation of the tracking shot, the crane shot. A crane shot is a shot taken from a special device called a crane or a jib, which resembles a huge mechanical arm that can be moved around a set. The crane generally carries both the camera and the cameraman, and can move in virtually any direction. In many ways, you can think of a crane shot as a vertical tracking shot, and they are often distinguished by their generous use of height provided by the crane. Crane shots are used in many ways. Narratively, they are a super effective form of the establishing shot, and they are frequently used to survey an entire setting, giving the audience a core sense of place. They can also be used to focus on a specific character, following them on the ground and then pulling out to a dynamic high-angle shot to perhaps demonstrate their loneliness, emotional state, or to demonstrate the effects of their actions. After the crane shot, we have another form of the tracking shot, the handheld shot. The handheld shot, also sometimes referred to as the shaky shot, is pretty much exactly as it sounds. It's a shot in which the camera operator holds the camera during motion to create a jerky immediate feel. It's important that we distinguish this from handheld shots achieved with the use of a Steadicam, as we group those generally into the more broad tracking shot. Instead, for our purposes, a handheld shot specifically uses the shakiness of holding the camera to its advantage to achieve certain narrative effects. Generally, we often see handheld shots, along with quick cuts, used for fight scenes, to heighten the action and keep the audiences on their toes. By keeping the shakiness in the shot, these fight scenes feel more emotional and immediate, and carry more grit to them rather than if a steady shot had been used. We also see them used almost entirely in found footage type films, like Cloverfield, in which the film is shot throughout to appear to audiences as if it was found on a handheld camera. In this case, handheld shots are used to make the audiences feel like they're part of the action, heightening all the emotions felt by the actors. One of the core reasons why this format is popular in horror and thriller films. And with that, we have our final movement technique, as well as the last discourse technique we will be discussing. The long take. Before we discuss the long take in particular, it's important to note that the length of shots used in film is an incredibly powerful tool used by filmmakers. Generally, the shorter the shot lengths, the quicker the pacing feels, and the more action-like a film will feel. On the opposite end of the spectrum from quick takes, we have long takes, which are, as the name implies, one long continuous shot, not broken up with edits. To pull off a successful long take requires a lot of skill from everyone involved in the filmmaking process. Not only do actors in the scene only have one chance to put out their best performance, but every single element of that long take must be perfect at the time of shooting. Because of this difficulty, however, some of the most famous shots in all of film happen to be long takes, like this particular shot from 400 Blows. In this famous scene, which concludes the film, we follow the protagonist running down to the beach, away from his detention facility. It's important to know that this boy has had an incredibly rough life, and has never seen the ocean before. In this landmark final long take, we watch as he runs away and down to the beach, adding a sense of realism and allowing the audience to realize the scope of his wonder at viewing the ocean for the first time. Furthermore, the final zooming in on his face, which signals the end of the film, leaves the audience in total contemplation over what he is feeling through his facial expression. And that wraps up our discussion on movement as a theme of visual rhetoric. Of course, I haven't brought up anywhere near the amount of techniques that exist in film discourse on the whole, but I hope this primer on film discourse technique, specifically focusing on visual rhetoric's themes in image, with shots, angles, and color, and movement, will be of use to you. There are a myriad of visual rhetoric techniques that the medium provides us, which aren't afforded for in other mediums, like text or comics. And having a background knowledge in these techniques is core to understanding visual forms of narrative and how to create them effectively. My name is Brian Klee, and thank you for watching.
And like that, he's gone.